Hello, Gavin Hoey here with part two of our infrared photography tutorial. Now, in the last video, we looked at how to take the infrared pictures with your digital camera. In this section, we're going to have a look at post-processing in Photoshop. Now, one thing I forgot to mention in the taking video was that the pictures were all taken in RAW format. It doesn't have to be RAW, but boy does it help if you can use RAW. So let's get the best of the pictures onto the screen. So I've got a file, open, and I'm going to open the RAW picture. Now, this will open it up into Adobe Camera Raw, which is the piece of software that sits between your raw images in your camera and Photoshop itself. Now, this is where you can make some changes to your picture and really make life easier in the next section. So here's the picture as it came off the camera. You can see it's got this lovely bright red horrible look, but don't worry, we're going to sort that out in just a few seconds. In fact, we're going to sort out the color temperature first of all. Because I had the camera set to auto white balance, the temperature setting is, well, whatever it was at the moment I pressed the shutter. But in Camera Raw, we can actually push the temperature slider even further towards the blue. In other words, we can get rid of more of the red, which is what we'll do there. Now, to take away any lingering colour at all, we're going to make this black and white by taking the saturation slider and moving it all the way down to minus 100. So we're back to a black and white picture. Now, you may be sitting there thinking, well, hang on a minute, if it's black and white, why bother about the colour temperature? Well, surprisingly enough, it does matter. If I move this temperature slider around, you can start to see the difference that it makes. So it does make a difference. Looking at the picture itself, and particularly looking at the histogram up at the top here, you can see the whole picture is in fact a little underexposed. Even though I used the picture that had the longest exposure time, the 5 second one, the end result is still a picture that looks a little bit dark to our eyes. But again, RAW comes in to help here. We can just get the exposure slider and slide it up around about a stop, and that kind of evens up our histogram. More importantly, it looks better on the screen. Now, I'd like to try and bring out some of the contrast from the picture because it's a little bit flat. There was lovely lighting here. Typically enough, no sooner than I put my camera on the tripod, then the lovely lighting vanished. But there we go. We can help to enhance what was there by increasing the contrast. Let's grab the contrast slider like so, and increasing the clarity as well, like that. Okay, so that's all looking a lot nicer now. I can click Open Image and we'll bring that image into Photoshop to do the last bit because there are some things you can't do inside of RAW. Now, we'll just take a second to process. And here it is. Okay, so there's the picture on screen. And what we're going to do now is to try and reproduce some of the looks of a film-based infrared image, which tended to have a lot more softness to it. And also, if I was doing this in the good old wet darkroom days, I'd have probably put a bit of toning and a bit of dodging and burning. So we're going to do that too. Right, let's start off by making this a softer image. We'll come up to Layer and duplicate the layer, or press Ctrl-J or Command-J on a Mac, or however you like to do it, so you have an exact copy of that layer. Now, that copy layer we're going to blur. So let's come up to Filter, choose Blur, and then Gaussian Blur. And we're going to blur this, well, what about 25 pixels, somewhere around about there, and we'll click OK. So that's given us quite a blurry image, but we want to see some sharpness through it, so we're going to change the blend mode. Up at the top of the layers, here it says Normal, click the little down arrow, and well, you can either choose overlay or soft light or whatever you like really, but I tend to prefer overlay because it does give a bit of a kick to the contrast. But if that's a little bit too strong, then you can try soft light instead. And I think in this instance, soft light works better because it actually retains a little bit more cloud detail. Right, color is the next thing. So I'm going to put some color adjustment in here by going to an adjustment layer and going with the Hue Saturation Adjustment layer and clicking Colorize. Okay, so this will put a tone over the image. The default color, if you have black and white as your default color settings on your foreground and background, which I have, the default color for the Colorize is this hideous red color. Really does, I don't like that at all. Fortunately, it's just a matter of moving the Hue slider. Move the Hue slider and you can have, well, blues, you can have any color you like in there. I always like sort of sepia tones. I don't know why. I just like the look of a sepia tone. Just drop the saturation down. That seems to work well for infrared images, to me anyway. Right, now that's pretty much done for that picture. I'm kind of happy with that. But if I was working in a wet darkroom, I'd have not left the picture like this. I'd have looked at it and thought, well, you know, I could do a darkening down this corner a little bit, perhaps, because the other three corners are darker. And there's no reason why we can't do that in Photoshop as well. First of all, let's flip back to the layers and make sure we're working on one of the layers. I prefer to work on the blurred layer. And then we'll grab ourselves the burn tool, which you're going to find on the toolbar right there. We're working on the midtones. We've got the exposure banged right up to the top. And we're just going to put a few little clicks down here and just darken this corner down. So what will happen is this light patch in the middle will become a lot more dominant, a lot more bold. And that should just give an extra feeling of interest to the picture because you have a more range of tones going through it. It just makes it more pleasing to the eye. Okay, so there you go. There's how you can turn an infrared raw image into a lovely sepia-toned black and white.